Hi, I'm Father Chris Ahlar, and welcome to another edition of Ask a Marian. Cassandra from Ames, Iowa asks, along with St. Faustina and John Paul II, who would you say is the greatest saint of our times? Well, Cassandra, I believe, and many in the church do, that it's a saint by the name of Francesco Forgione, later known as St. Padre Pio, who is called by many the greatest saint of our times, along with John Paul and St. Faustina. He was born to peasant farmers in 1887 in Italy and died on today's date, September 23rd, in 1968. You know, it's amazing because his parents, although they were illiterate, they went to daily mass, very faithful, and even memorized the scriptures. So he had a strong faith, and when he was only five, his mother said that he could see and speak to Jesus, Mary, and even his guardian angel. So God gave him many spiritual gifts, like healing, bilocation, levitation, prophecy, miracles, and even living long periods only on the Eucharist. And also, most famously, he was known for reading souls. So he is a heavyweight saint. You know, he was ordained in 1910 and soon afterwards started receiving the stigmata, which is when a person bears the wounds of Christ's crucifixion in their own body, their hands, feet, side, even the head with the crown of thorns. But this would remain with him for over 50 years. It didn't go away. So by 1916, early in his priesthood, he entered the Franciscan Friary of San Giovanni Rotondo. Now, he was a friar. People call him a monk. What's the difference? Okay, a friar is different from a monk in that they are called to live out in the world, to do service in society, rather than live a cloistered monk in a monastery. It's the same with sisters and nuns. Nuns live a cloistered life in a convent. They don't go out. A sister actually goes out into the community amongst the lay people in the world. Now, when he died, the stigmata had completely disappeared without a scar, and his body was found empty of all blood. You know, 80% of all stigmatas are women, but the very first ones were really, first one recorded was St. Francis, and maybe the first one ever was even St. Paul, because he says in the Bible that his body bore the wounds of Christ. So anyway, that being said, Padre Pio was probably the most famous of them all. Each day he would lose about one cup of blood, but the wounds, they never closed, they never festered, and also a sweet odor came from them instead of a smell of like pus or infection. You know, one day he was even asked by the future John Paul, Pope John Paul, only when he was a cardinal, which wound caused him the most pain in his stigmata. Now, expecting Padre Pio to say that it was his chest wound, he didn't. He said it was the wound on his shoulder. Now, that isn't surprising, because Jesus also told St. Bernard of Clairvaux that of all his wounds, the worst, by far, was one not even recorded in the Bible, on his shoulder. And this wound isn't even, as I said, recorded. Jesus said the wood tore into his flesh and tore it down to the bone. You know, before I became a priest, I used to pray the prayer to the shoulder wound of Christ by St. Bernard every day. This was before I was a Marian. And once I became a Marian, we had so many other prayers, I didn't keep praying it. And now I think I should, because this is so powerful. And now I'd like to share that same prayer with you. Let us together pray this prayer. Most loving Jesus, meek Lamb of God, I, a miserable sinner, salute and worship the most sacred wound of your shoulder, on which you did bear your heavy cross, which so tore your flesh and laid bare the bones as to inflict on you an anguish greater than any other wound of your most blessed body. I adore you, O Jesus, most sorrowful. I praise and glorify you and give you thanks for this most sacred and painful wound, beseeching you, by that exceeding pain and by the crushing burden of your heavy cross, to be merciful to me, a sinner, and forgive me all my mortal and venial sins, and lead me on towards heaven along the way of the cross. Amen. Wow. Jesus promises to all those who venerate his wound and say this prayer that he will remit all their venial sins and no longer remember their mortal sins. So pray this prayer every day if you can. You know, Padre Pio is also known for amazing miracles. One was a woman who was born without pupils, and she came to Padre Pio. Her mother brought her when she was just a little girl after Mass. And like Jesus, Padre Pio rubbed her eyes. This woman, named Gemma Di Giorgi, regained her sight, and she's alive today. But here's the amazing thing. Yes, why it's quite miraculous that she regained her sight and can now see. What is even more startling is that she still doesn't have any pupils. How can she see without any pupils in her eyes? Well, ask Padre Pio, or better yet, ask God, who used Padre Pio to heal her. In another story, do you remember C. Everett Koop, the former U.S. Surgeon General under President Reagan in the 1980s? Well, back in 1966, he was a doctor in the case of little Vera Marie Calandra, and she was born with a congenital kidney condition. And after several surgeries, Dr. Koop had to remove the poor little girl's bladder and told her parents that she would undoubtedly die very soon. Now, strong in her faith, her mother, having heard of Padre Pio and his healing miracles, took the girl to San Giovanni Rotondo, where they met the priest. He blessed her and placed his stigmatic hands on her. And when they returned home, to Dr. Koop's shocking amazement, he discovered inside the child was growing a new bladder to replace the old one. Now, this just doesn't happen. Bladders don't grow. She was completely recovered. Now, then there is my favorite miracle of any saint, the one they call the flying monk, or I guess, again, as I said, we should call the flying friar. You know, the story goes back in World War II when he was a monk there in San Giovanni Rotondo. The Germans had taken over the area and they had taken possession of the monastery. And reports were that they had some ammunition and some material there and some resources. So the Allied bombers, American and other bombers, went to try to destroy this location. It was a German stronghold. But every time the planes went up into the air, the planes were forced to turn around, even though the pilots couldn't control it, by a flying monk. Every time they tried to drop their bombs, it wouldn't work because of this flying monk. And all the pilots who came back, they were not wanting to tell each other the story because they were afraid they would be called crazy. So finally, after the war, one of the generals, who still was perplexed by this, wanted to solve the mystery. So he got a bunch of the pilots together. Here you can see their pictures. And they went to the monastery, trying to figure out who this monk was, because they got rumors that there was some special monk living in the monastery. And soon as they got there, lo and behold, who did they all see? Padre Pio. And immediately they pointed to him, and all the pilots knew this was the monk. That monk, surprisingly, protected that monastery, and no harm was done to it. You know, he survived on only 3.5 ounces of food a day, which isn't even enough to feed an infant. Yet he weighed more than 170 pounds. And his fellow friars often heard sounds of the devil's attacks on him coming from his cell at night, and in the morning he'd be full of bruises. Evidence is his fighting the devil with his humility and obedience. What a lesson for us today, and that's why he is called, along with John Paul II and St. Faustina, the greatest saint of our times. So, when times get tough, do what Padre Pio said, pray, hope, and don't worry. Now, if you want more details on Padre Pio, please see my talk from last Saturday on YouTube called Explaining the Faith, the Greatest Saint of Our Times, Padre Pio and the Stigmata. And until next week, may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.